ensemble learning, depending on how you like to pronounce it.
Can anyone define what is an ensemble?
A collection or
something. Okay, so how many of us have watched Conrad and the English people in the office? You want to be in the air. Okay. So sometimes, I'm sure all of us have seen those episodes where a contestant calls his relative, his other relative, on phone, and the super expert behind the phone very confidently gives the wrong answer. Has anyone seen episodes like that? And sometimes we see that the innocent looking crowd is also able to get the correct answer. Right? The crowd is not, you know, the so called GK experts or so, but they're still able to get the correct answer. Can you think of a logical explanation for that? And why I'm discussing this in the screen. And specifically for the topic of ensemble learning.
Sample space
is big, okay. Anyone heard of the book Wisdom of the Crowd? Or heard of the term? Wisdom of the Crowd? Crowd. So the idea that I was trying to propose or discuss here was that when you phone a friend, you have got a so-called, a very strong classifier, let's say. So let's say it's a classification task or it's a strong expert advice that you have to get. But that can be wrong, right? But sometimes what can happen is when you have a collection of, let's say, the audience who are relatively weak, none of them is a GK expert, they're still able to get the answer correctly on average, right? So with that intuition, we're going to approach the idea behind ensemble learning that sometimes a collection of so-called weak learners can outperform so-called strong learners or a better classification or regression learner, right? The core ideas you would have already figured out by now is that we're going to use multiple models for prediction. And one of the reasons ensemble learning or ensemble learning is very popular is that for many cattle populations, ensemble learning solutions have been the top entries. If you look at the various algorithms, you'll see many times people either use things like random forest or XGBoost, and they end up winning these competitions. Of course, now people are now, the larger rates of people are also using a lot of neural networks. How do we predict in case of ensemble learning? Let's say we have three different classifiers. We have thus far not discussed how to create these different classifiers. There could be many different ways. Two classifiers say it is good, the output is good, and one say it's bad. So the case of classification, you do majority voting. And what is the answer that you get now?
Good.
Because two out of the three majority say that it's good. What do we do in the case of regression? We just get the mean, right? Mean or median. So someone is a median summary statistic. In the case of classification, we do the majority vote. And in the case of regression case, let's say one of them predicts 20, 30, and 30. The output that we predict from the ensemble is the average across the different base learners, the different classifiers. Okay.
So there are three important reasons why ensembles
make sense. Can anyone take a shot? Why do you think ensemble learning will work? So you have to tell why ensemble give you a higher probability of getting the correct.
If the probability of each of them is greater than 50%,
okay.
Then if you combine
probability of what is greater than 50%?
Getting the right answer.
Okay, so he's saying the probability of getting the right answer for each of the classifiers, let's discuss classification only for now, is greater than 50%, then it is more likely to get the right answer. Who agrees? So the answer he is given is that if let's say you have multiple of these classifiers and the probability of accuracy on each of them is, let's say, more than 50%, if you combine them, then the overall probability of being correct will increase. Does everyone agree? disagrees? What if I say you get a plus one if you get the right answer and then why you get a critical? So what you said is almost correct. There is one certain condition which you have missed, which we will discuss now. You know why? Okay, any other reasons why ensemble learning might make sense? So what we call is more of a quantitative understanding. Can you tell more of, so can we think of more conceptual understanding also? Why ensemble learning might make sense? Expectation. If your answer is still pretty much on the same lines, so I want to think a little out of the box. So forget about getting more than two classifiers with a certain probability. Why should it still work? Okay, so this is a good, interesting answer. Now let's say we think that it could help us overcome overfitting. Why is that? Okay, so you can cancel out each other there. That's somewhat on the right track. Let's see one answer. So the first reason is called a statistical reason, which is to say that if the data is less, can we have multiple hypotheses which are competing with each other? So for example, if the data is really small, we're trying to learn decision trees. Can you learn 30 decision trees on the same data? All of which give the same accuracy? So you can do that. Given that the data is fairly small, and let's say you have a lot of features. So you can still be able to get, you may not be able to get the exact same predictions for each case, but you can still get the same accuracy, or roughly the same accuracy. And depending on things like initialization of the criteria that you use, we can learn many different decision trees. None of them is correct or of its own. What we're saying is that since the data is not enough, they are competing, all of them give the same measure of accuracy. So what we are saying is that since all of them are giving the same measure of accuracy, can we combine their strengths and weaknesses? They combine strengths, we don't want to combine weaknesses, we want to overcome them. The second reason is computational in nature. For example, there are some classifiers which can get stuck in local optima, right? Or which make some locally optimal decisions. Does the decision tree make any locally optimal decision? I said the answer for asking question. So it has a greedy element to it, right? It looks at only the next best step. It looks at the next step in which it is trying to compute the best attribute for reducing the entropy, right? So many of these can get stuck in local optima. And once we discuss things like neural networks, and those of you who have studied things like neural networks, you would already know that neural networks are very prone to getting stuck in local optima. So what ensemble learning here is saying that we can have multiple such learners, or multiple such neural networks, or multiple such decisions learned. Each of them built on some locally optimal criteria, which none of them is the true criteria, none of them is the true relationship between the input and the outputs. But since you have multiple optima, you assume that if you average them, you should be able to get something close. Again, there are some hidden caveats that all of them should not be stuck at the local, same local optima, or all should be, let's say, there is some true function, some true relationship, all of these are somewhere around it, and not on one particular side. So decision trees imply the unique criteria, which means they can get, they are prone to be locally stuck in a model. The third one is probably the easiest one to understand. That some classifiers and regressors are not capable of learning the proof or representation. Does anyone want to explain what this line means? Think only about the things you have learned till now. You have only learned decision trees. Are there certain things which decision trees cannot learn or can learn?
and maybe you restrict the difficulties of.
So, can I speak a little about it? That's exactly one of the reasons. And why do dictionaries not able to learn perfect circles? So, dictionaries only make, you just split the whole search space into two parts each time, right? So, that is a perfect answer. I have the same example on my side problem. Let's assume that this is the input data. And for now, keep things even simpler. Let's assume that we are allowed to learn decision trees only at depth 1, which are also called decision sums. So in this particular case, you can see that it is not able to capture the specific property where these two are interacting with each other. These two classes have. So these two classes cannot be separated out so easily as by a single script, which is the decision tree is trying to do. Similarly, for this case, which is there is one class within a circle, so, and the other class is on the outer circle. Now, again, we try to learn a decision tree, it will again only try to maximize the accuracy it can obtain by making a single script, because we have limited ourselves to master. But what I'm showing on the right hand side for both of these is what is the output of random forest. Without going into details, we look at the details later. The random forest is making multiple such trees. So it has multiple such decision trees. So random forest, this is one tree. Let's say if you were to change something in the data, or I don't know the specifics, but we end up learning multiple such trees, and one such tree is split horizontal, and one such tree, the split could be vertical. The split points could vary, but this random forest is made from 100 decision trees of depth 1. And are we able to get a far better decision boundaries between the two classes? Far better. So, although there is some amount of ambiguity in this region, you see the color of blue is slightly lighter compared to the color of blue on the extreme right, where we much more confident. Similarly, if you look at the plot below, here you can see that it's largely able to get the concept of a circle compared to the decision tree, which is only trying to make a single point. Right? And if you also look at the accuracy scores, it's not so easy to look. But for the decision tree, the accuracy score is 0.75. Or 75%, for the random forest it is 88%, and for the dataset below it's 65% for the decision tree. It's a much more higher problem to solve. And for the random forest it is 78%. Now this is again fairly simple combination of very weak classification models. Random forest has done. So this is what I wanted to highlight, that the decision tree in this case does not have the representation ability to learn such complicated decision boundaries, right? It cannot learn a circle, it can only learn lines. But if you combine many of these lines, you'll be able to get something close to a circle. That's why in simple learning, you're able to overcome the representation limit that some classifiers or universal people are. Oh, this is the same experiment which I did for depth equal to 2. So for depth equal to 2, you can see that the decision tree is, in the first case, is significantly better. In the second case, it's still not good enough, although it's now trying to make two partitions. And the random forest with using decision trees of depth 2 is able to do a fairly good job. The accuracy is 85% compared to the early time.
Okay, so now we come to, the more, theory grounded part of this. What are some of the necessary and sufficient conditions for ensemble learning to work well? We start with that the classifiers need to be more accurate. So the ensemble learning will turn out to be more accurate than the individual classifiers. If the classifiers are accurate in megawatts. Now you have to tell me the definition of accurate in megawatts. What does being accurate mean? Is high. Can it, so he's saying that the performance score is high defines accuracy. Can you be more specific? What do you mean by high? And what is what do you mean by performance score? Okay. Can you low could mean loss of in terms of let's say accurate, low could mean an error of 10%, it could mean an error of 40%. Right? Can you quantify that? Can you tell the limit? So it's independent of the number of classes. Or for now, just assume it could be a very simple two class classification problem. You only have to tell me the number. The accuracy should be greater than something, or the error should be less than something. No, this is independent of the algorithm. These are necessary and sufficient conditions, irrespective of how you can assemble it. But each of the individual classifiers should have a minimum accuracy of 50%, not complicated, right? Everyone knew the answer, but for this, not sure about this. So, accurate classifier is an error rate of better than random guessing. Random guessing, you know, that's 50% error, right? What do you mean by the classifiers should be diverse? And why is the first condition in itself not enough? Yes. Okay. So one view of this particular problem is that if you have, say, 11. You're making an ensemble of 11 classifiers, but all 11 of them are the same. You get an advantage, then the output will be the same as the each of the 11. Can you give some other examples of why we need the diversity? What do you mean by diversity? Okay, so he's saying that if all of the classifiers tend to be, if they tend to be the same, then you'll not be able to learn properties of the server. Okay, but can you tell something more to diversity?
When do you say that two classifiers are diverse?
Okay, that's pretty much on the line. So they make different errors on new data points or testing points, which is pretty much on the line of they give different predictions. They have to make different kinds of errors. If all of them are making the same kind of error, you're not getting it. You're hoping that the error will get handled. Let's imagine that we have three classifiers, H1, H2, H3. For the purposes of simplicity, you would because we have started only decision trees till now. Think of them as we have three decision trees, H1, H2, and H3. Or those, or you could also think of in terms of things like linear regression, you have three different relationships. So three different relationships between the output and the input. And you have a new data point X. Okay? If all of these classifiers are identical, exactly identical, which means that there is no diversity, then if H1 is wrong, H1 of X is the first relationship. If that is wrong, then H2 and H3 will also be wrong. Right? You have not gained any information that way. But if the errors made by them are uncorrelated, then you'll see that if H1 is wrong And because you assume that majority of, you also assume that they have errors less than 50%, right? So then it is very likely that the other two might be correct. Right? One is wrong, the other two might be correct. So a majority vote will end up predicting the correct loss. Did everyone get the last point which I was trying to make? So both of these conditions are needed together. One, each of the classifier has to have an error rate of less than 50%. The second, they should be diverse. Let's try to work it out now that to prove that using multiples of such accurate, which is less error, and diverse classifiers will lead to an improvement in the graph of an error. So let's for now assume that the error of each model is 0.03, or the accuracy is 0.7 in equivalent terms. And we have three such classifiers, H1, H2, H3. Right? What is the probability that the majority will be wrong? Can you compute that using the binomial expression? So firstly, you use a 3 choose 2 term, and then you have one term where you have two of them being wrong. So two of them being wrong, which means that so probability of error times probability of error times probability of 1 minus error. So that is epsilon squared times multiplied by 1 minus epsilon raised to the power 1. Plus all three of them are wrong. Probability of error times probability of error times probability of error multiplied by 1 minus epsilon raised to the power 0. Right? This turns out to be 0.19, which is much less than 0.8. Right? So seems pretty simple now, right? So we can always just create an example and get a better accuracy or reduce the error. But is there a hidden caveat here, or is there anything important that we missing? Sorry?
Less than equal.
Yeah, so less than equal to 0.3. So what I was trying to say was, if ensemble learning can reduce the error by a significant amount of error, so it's saving over 10 units over 30 units, right? 33% improvement. Why can't we just use ensemble learning and everywhere? Why don't we use it everywhere? Sorry.
Yes,
perfect. So one of the, in the previous slide, we saw this condition that the errors are uncorrelated. Right? In an ideal case, errors should very likely be correlated with each other. Right? If they are very likely to be correlated with each other, this number would be very likely to be very close to 0.0, only slightly better. And if they are also correlated with each other, then can you use this formula? Not directly, because this assumes what? All the draws are independently drawn, right? Let's look at even more draws now. Let's assume that we have an ensemble of 21 classifiers, and each of them have the probability of being wrong as 0.3, and what we're saying is that the majority is wrong is the cases when at least 11 of them are wrong. So if you first draw the distribution of p of x equal to k, so you're plotting the probability mass function of k classifiers being errors, you observe that firstly there will be a peak around 6 or 7. That's linked to the fact that the error rate is 0.3. And once you go around the majority line, which is 11 and above, the probability of errors, which is going to be the sum of all of these now, right? It's failure. Right? So what it is telling you is if all of these were in the ideal case perfectly uncorrelated, then you can get a massive increase in accuracy or massive reduction in the error. Now let us confirm the case if error is greater than 0.5. What will happen? So if the error is, let's say, 0.6, now this distribution will have a tail which is more than 10, right? Because the probability of error of each of the term is greater than 0.5. The mean of this distribution will be greater than 10. And now if we add up or see the area under the curve for this particular distribution, it turns out to be 0.826. So combining classifiers having a high error rate leads to degradation in performance. So these are two important things you need to always think about. Okay, we have already discussed to some sense. Ensemble learning will not work when the base model itself is bad and if all the models are giving us fairly similar prediction, all the models are highly correlated. So two important conditions you want to remember. Base model being bad means the accuracy is less than the error is greater than 50%. Now we look at the first ensemble learning technique, which is known as bagging or bootstrap aggregation. And the key idea in this approach is to reduce variance. In the previous lecture, we saw two kinds of errors. One was bias, one is variance. Can anyone remind us what is variance? Okay, anything else beyond the term overfitting? What do you mean by when you say you have the model is high variance? So we are saying the difference in the accuracy between training and testing is high. Okay, so that's so what I'm trying to understand is what does the term variance actually mean in terms of the model and in terms of if you perform some perturbation in the data. Okay, so if you change the input even slightly, you'll end up with very different models, right? That is also the notion of that is another interpretation of variance. And what we are now trying to do is to reduce variance. And thus far, we have got the idea that we are trying to combine different models. So, this already should be giving you some hints as to what we are trying to do. Okay, so how do we learn different classifiers? Maybe we've got the same data. Okay, so that's a very good idea. So once you try, so you're trying to learn different classifiers. There could be multiple things which you could weigh in order to get different classifiers. One which Nihal is suggesting is that we can take different features for each of the classifiers. Right? Let's say we have 5 features. We allow only a subset of the features to be used in each classifier. Yes? Can we do that? Okay, what could be the other ways in which we can create multiple classifiers? Different depth of the decision tree. Okay, so one, you're varying the features of the data set itself. Second, you're varying the hyperparameters of the modeling approaches itself. So, I'm not going into much depth in this particular lecture, but hyperparameter is something which you are not learning from the tree, you are not learning from the data. You're giving before you're starting the training process or the learning process. So that's the depth of the tree you can specify as an argument or you can specify that before learning. The maximum depth is certain. That's a hyperparameter, not a parameter. Yes, so you could vary the hyperparameters, you could vary the features. What else could you vary? Number of samples, okay. You could vary the number of samples or in terms of what she is saying, you could vary the data. Right, you could do some sampling from the data set to create different data sets. Which of them do you think we'll be using here? Look at the keywords mentioned, reduce variance and different classifiers will be in the same data. So, what was the definition of variance? I just said a couple of minutes back. If you choose different data sets or perturbations of data set, you learn different classifiers. Okay, so that is going to be the key intuition here that we'll be looking at multiple data sets, which will be creating from the same data. And how can we do that? How can you create multiple data sets from a single data set? No, so for now, let's not think about validation and test. Let's only think about a single data set. Let's say you have 100 samples. You want to? Okay, so even if you change the alignment, for decision trees, it will not make any impact. There are some algorithms for which changing the order might make a difference. But we are not changing the order, we need to create multiple data sets. Okay. Why we did that in cross-validation? But all of your answers are fairly on track. If you take an example, the answer would be of your answer. The answer that was. Okay. So, he's saying that if there are a lot of attributes, you change one attribute slightly, the answer should be same. We can do that, but that's not exactly that it. That is something else. So, we can discuss that towards the second half of the course when we look at things like triplet dynamics, if we look at that. But for now, let's concentrate on this word sampling with this. The idea is that if you have n samples, D1 through Dn, for each model in the ensemble, you will have a new data set of same size n, right? And the way you're able to still get a data set of size n from a data set of size n is by sampling the replacement, right? Does everyone here understand what sampling the replacement means? So if you have 100 numbers here, or if you have 100 notebooks here, or 100 balls over here, sampling the replacement is you pick one ball, you keep it back, it can be sampled there. Right? So if you do that, can you create a data set of size in the sampling from a data set of size n? Yes? Each of the samples that you're drawing is incrementally drawn from the entire sample space. Round 1 could be D1, D3, D6, D1, Dn. And as you would have expected, there is a certain probability that you end up repeating some elements. Right? Some of the elements repeated, some of the elements are omitted in the different data sets, in the different rounds of the algorithm. And then we end up using the same classifier or model across each of these rounds, and each of these rounds are called as bagging rounds, bootstrap aggregation, bagging rounds. So you train a classifier on round 1, on round 2 data set, on round 3 data set, for the number of rounds that you have, right? So now you've learned m different classifiers or regressive models. Let's look at this data. Can you see the colors? Properly, are you able to discern the colors? Can you see the yellow dot at the top? And can you see the blue dot on the bottom? These two points are probably anomalies, right? If a human being were to take a decision tree for this data set, you would probably have something like x2 greater than equal to 5.5 and x1 greater than equal to 5.5. You would create a square like this. Yes, that sounds reasonable. But decision trees will not do that because they are very prone to variance. They try to complicate things by learning very deep decision trees, trying to get very high accuracy in the training. Right? Let's learn a decision tree on this with no depth control. So you allow the decision tree to learn whatever it wants to learn. You can see that it's now learned these. It's trying to also get these two points which are anomalies correctly. But that is not going to deliver as well. So the test accuracy will go down. And this is also a case of variance. Right? Now let's use an ensemble of 5 trees. So for the purpose of creating the framework, we first create a background one, which is uniformly sampling with replacement rate set of 5n. So in round one, you see that a lot of the points are different, right? And some of the points which would be definitely drawn on open mass. But I'm showing them only one thing. I'm not showing them multiple times. Can you see that particular blue point over here? No? But the yellow point over here is still present. Okay. Let's look at another second round, another round of bagging. Now this blue point has appeared in this particular round, but the yellow point in the round in the top is not there. Round 3, the blue point is still occurred happening, the yellow point is missing. Round 4, both the anomalous points are missing. Round 5, one of the anomalous points is present. Right? Now let us try to see what will happen if we try to learn different decision trees without any depth control on these variables. Round 1, we learn a decision tree of depth 4, which is still trying to classify this yellow point at the top correctly. So it still has an amount of variance, still has an amount of bad performance. Round 2 is now trying to get this blue point in the middle of the yellow point correctly. So it ends up learning a very weird decision boundary. Round 3 also had this anomalous point in between, so it ends up again learning something weird looking. Round 4 is all lines with what you want to predict, right? And round 5 is very similar to round 1. There's some difference in the sample points, but the boundary learned is very similar, right? Now, can you see that if we somehow combine all of these models, we'll be able to predict the decision boundary correctly? Can you see that? So we have 5 different classifiers, right? Let's look at only this particular point. How many classifiers are marking this as red? This round 5 classifier is marking this point as red, and round 1 classifier is marking this yellow anomalous point at the top as red. 2 out of the 5? 3 out of the 5 classifiers are marking it correctly as blue. Right? So if you have to do a majority voting on a test point which lies somewhere close to this yellow point at the top, what class will you predict? Blue. Right? Thus you can see that bagging has allowed you to reduce the variance. Let's look at this particular point, the blue anomalous point around 3-3. Again, 2 classifiers are getting it correctly, the remaining 3 classifiers are getting it correctly. Thus, if we combine all of the predictions, we are able to get the overall prediction as follows. Did everyone understand how we are able to get this decision boundary by combining the different 5 decision boundaries? If not, let me know. So what you're trying to do is to put each point now that you want to predict, you look at the class predicted for each of the ensemble from each of the models, and then you do a majority. And then you can plot the decision curve. Right? So in bagging, we have seen that we are taking some very strong learners. By strong, I mean that they're able to get very high accuracy on what they're training for. But what we're trying to do is to reduce variance. Each of the strong learners is prone to high variance. So we end up learning learners which are somewhat independent of each other. They're not perfectly independent of each other. And this was done by drawing multiple samples from the data set. How do you choose these? Okay, the question is how do you choose the different bagging rounds? Anyone has suggestions? Okay, random, but he also knows that the answer was random. You want to be more specific? So if you're asking about purposes in programming, then the answer is there would be some module in NumPy, like NumPy.random.all. joins with a certain size, and you get the set from which you're trying to sample. In the way it might be implemented is you pick one sample at a time. It will be recognized for it. Typically, out of the 100 samples, let's say, you would pick one, keep it back, and then again at random you can pick any other number. And stop in the cycle. Okay, so the question is, how many bagging rounds should we choose? The number of samples in each bagging round is n, is the same as the number of samples. So this particular algorithm that we've seen, you start with a data set of samples number equal to n. Each of the bagging rounds also has n samples.
But there are some missing samples.
There will be missing samples because there will be some repeated samples. Of course, there could be variants of this particular algorithm that you're seeing, where instead of choosing n samples, you choose some fraction of the n samples, right, in each round. But for this implementation, we'll fix the number of samples in each bagging round to n.
The number of bagging rounds depends on the sample size.
I don't think I have a very good answer. Anyone else has any thoughts? So the question is, how should we choose the number of bagging rounds, specifically in terms of the number of data points that you have? Would you have some relationship between them? Like, if the data set is large, you have large number of bagging rounds. Or anyone has any thoughts? Yeah, I don't think I have a very good answer at this point of time, but we can look at that. If the data set is skewed, we might end up requiring more arms. So skewed means more outliers. Okay, if the number of outliers are more, then you require more rounds. Okay. So he's suggesting a heuristic that you learn, keep on. So you do this in an online fashion, let's say. You don't first fix the number of bagging rounds, you incrementally keep on increasing the number of bagging rounds. And if you end up seeing that there is a high amount of correlation amongst the classifiers, then bagging is not good. Yes. In the IDP, they should be. These are all good questions. And in practice, what I tell you is that some of these questions are being irrelevant in favor of the empirical analysis. You can empirically also find many of these. You figure out that n such bagging rounds works best, n can be a hyperparameter. So you can also do that. But we'll get back to these questions later. For now, let's take another different approach of ensemble learning. First, we saw some very strong classifiers which had higher amount of variance. Now we're trying to look at, so we have addressed the variance problem to an extent. Can we address the bias problem to an extent? That's the question. And what do you associate with high bias? The model is not trained sufficient, it's not strong enough, right? You can associate all of these things with a high bias. You want to now reduce the bias. So what you do is to take multiple of such weak learners, which all of them have a high bias, and combine them. In the previous case, the learners were all learned independently, right? Each of the background had nothing to do with each other. But in the case of boosting, which is another type of ensemble learning, the learners are incrementally improved. You learn something, you take that as an input, you learn something else in the next cycle. And the key intuition is that you want to incrementally look at harder samples. So let's say iteration number one, you learned a weak classifier that got some points wrong. And the next iteration, your focus should be on those points which you got wrong. Right? So what you're trying to say is that those specific points which you're getting wrong is due to the fact that our learner has a high bias, and by focusing on the points you get wrong, you can reduce the bias. If this is not becoming intuitive, just hold on for a minute. The algorithm we're going to look at is called AdaBoost. Assume that now you have n samples, n equal to 10 over here. You associate a weight with each of the samples. Now this weight tells you about the importance of the sample, right? For now, let's assume that we will start with all of the samples being equally weighted, right? We'll have, let's say, n classifiers in the sample. We initialize the weight as 1 over n. So thus, each of the classifiers, each of the points has a weight of 0.1, right? We learn a weak classifier. In this case, I'm learning a weak classifier as a decision stamp, which I mentioned earlier. Decision stamp is a decision tree of depth 1. So you make only a single partition in the data, in the space. So you've learned this classifier, which is now correctly predicting the left yellow points, correctly predicting the right blue points, the right below blue points, and it's incorrectly predicting 3 points, right? Now the idea would be in the next iteration, we want to focus on these 3 points. How can we allow the algorithm to focus on these 3 points now? We have to increase it, right? So that's the key idea, the key intuition. So if you increase the weight, then you'll want to, so basically when you talk about accuracy, you should also then incorporate some notion of these weights. Okay. So for now, we have seen that these 3 points are misclassified. We compute the weighted error, and m small n here is denoting the iteration number. So the weighted error is the summation of wi's for the samples we have incorrectly classified. In this case, we have incorrectly classified 3 points. Their weighted sum is 3 to 0.1 divided by the weighted sum of all of the samples. Right? Just for simplicity, we always have the denominator as 1. So we have some normalization step. We incorrectly classified 3 samples, each of them at the same weight. The error at the first iteration is 0.3. Right? Now, some magic we'll see here, and then we'll figure out why this magic exists. We'll calculate a quantity alpha n, corresponding to the mth iteration. For the first iteration, it is half log of 1 minus error in this particular iteration divided by the error at this iteration. So since the error was 0.3, this quantity turns out to be 0.42. Right? So we've calculated some quantity now. Now we need to reweight. So we said that we incrementally want to focus on harder samples, which also means that if we want to focus on harder samples, we want to focus lesser on the easy samples. Does everyone understand that? Focusing on harder samples means focusing lesser on the easy samples. You reweight the samples for the ones which are predicted correctly. You reweight them by a factor of e to the power minus alpha n. And for the ones who predict wrongly, you weigh them by a factor of e to the power plus alpha, right? Seems like a bit of magic over there. Why are we looking at these two specific weights, we used to use specific multipliers. That's old on project. So we're now trying to do the reweighting step. These three samples were incorrectly weighted, incorrectly classified. So the previous weight is now multiplied by e to the power plus alpha n. Alpha n was 0.42, and the ones which were correctly identified, e to the power minus alpha. We do that for the 7 correctly classified and 3 wrongly classified samples. This gives us the relative weights as 0.15 for the 3 wrongly classified ones and 0.06 for the correctly classified ones
in the previous iteration. Right?
Now, does this already tell you that in the next iteration we will be focusing on these 3 samples which were previously misclassified? So that is the key intuition. But we also have now a normalization step. Just to keep things simple, we'll sum up all of these weights and so we'll normalize these and then by the sum of all these weights. So normalize otherwise to sum up to 1. So what you're effectively doing is 0.15 over 0.15 plus 0.15 plus 0.15 plus the sum of all these otherwise. Right? If you do that, you will now get the new weights 0.17 for these samples and 0.07 for the remaining samples.
Okay, so now tell me what relation sum could you learn?
My equals.
Equal to?
Like 3.50.
Okay, so you want to learn the classifier which will give you the least error at each iteration. At this iteration, let's look at the different classifiers we could have learned, right? One, we could have learned the same classifiers previously. What is the weighted error for this particular combination? The weighted error would be the sum of these three bits, which would be 0.51, which is 5. We could also learn the classifier by splitting on the y-axis at this point, right? So we are splitting the y-axis into two, so that the blue points below would be correctly classified and the yellow points above would be correctly classified. Then we still have three misclassified points. Can everyone see? We have a blue point at the top misclassified and two yellow points below misclassified. We still have three misclassified points. Previous iteration also had three misclassified points. But what has changed? The weight of each of these samples is lower, right? So now the error for this particular iteration is the summation of weights of incorrectly classified samples. That is 3 times 0.07, which is 0.21. And now if you get the alpha value, it turns out to be 0.66. Right? Now let's repeat the same procedure. What is the update formula for the correctly classified samples? E to the power minus alpha n. The multiplier and e to the power plus alpha is for the wrongly corrected. We do the same procedure again. Now you see that the weights of these three samples have gone down. Previously it was 0.17, so it's almost half because we've been able to correctly classify these three points in the previous iteration. Whereas the weights of these two yellow points and this particular blue point, which we incorrectly identified in the previous iteration, have gone up. It may make sense because we want to get them correctly in this next new iteration. We again normalize them to sum up to 1, which then means that this these set of weights change a little bit. The next iteration, I should stop it here.
So, what is the decision stump that we learn in this next iteration,
after this particular iteration? You have to again look at the weights. How does the model consider these weights? So, you can... did everyone get the question? How does the model consider these cases? I will try to boil the question now. So previously we were discussing about things like the different weights. All of the samples are equal, right? Now you are looking at a variant of the different weights where the accuracy or the weight of even the sample is not the same, right? Any thoughts on that? Did everyone get the question? So a trivial answer to this question is that let's, for the moment, not even think the entire decision tree algorithm. Let's think of, you're only now trying to find split points in a space. You can travel through all the split points and you can just sum the incorrectly counts right now. But if you look at in terms of the more complicated polar algorithms, then things will be different. This is slightly easier in terms of regression. Slightly contradictory. But you can again, for now, for the purpose of simplicity, just think of it as trying to find split points, because it will all be complicated. Okay, so what is the next classifier that we learn in this case? Sorry?
X-axis
at which point?
All
yellow would be on?
I mean,
okay, so he is saying that you draw a line with the same thing. Does that make sense? Why? So you want to get this point and this point and this point most accurately first, right? If you draw a line over here, which is similar to this, you'll still end up misclassifying a few points. This point, and this point, right? You'll misclassify 3 points,
but the weights are only 0.04.
Right? The sum of weights of incorrectly classified samples is then 0.12. You again reduce the weighted error, right? So we see all the iterations you're able to reduce the weighted error. If you compute alpha, it turns out to be 0.99. Right? So you're also seeing that the alpha is increasing over time as epsilon is decreasing. This correlation is by pure math, it's not something magical which is happening over here. Okay, so thus far everyone on board. Okay, how do we do the testing? So previous case when we were talking about in terms of bagging, testing was fairly easy, right? You just have to do a majority vote of any point across the different bagging rounds. How many of them are giving this a blue class or yellow class? And you just saw the majority vote, you got the answer. What happens in the case of hierarchies? You have some weird new numbers appearing here, right? You have some alpha, you have some error rates. You have to weight what every iteration. Yeah. What is the weight? Which iteration would you give more weight to? Sorry? Okay, so you're saying the first iteration should be given more weightage. Anyone who thinks the last iteration should be given more weight? Why? Because the error is less. The weighted error is less. Okay. And what weight could you use for these different classifiers? Alpha? Why? Alpha is increasing. So it turns out that the final prediction is the sign of, we come to what sign is there. The prediction of each of the classifiers is weighed by the alphas of that particular round, of that particular iteration. So it turns out to be alpha 1 times prediction of classifier 1 plus alpha 2 times prediction of classifier 2. So on. You compute this quantity and then you look at the sign. To illustrate this, let's look at these three iterations which we've seen thus far. Iteration 1, alpha 1 was 0.42. Iteration 2, alpha 2 was 0.66. Iteration 3, alpha 3 was 0.99. Let's imagine that now this hollow circle is the one which we want to make a prediction for. Can you tell me what you think would be the prediction for this class? How many think yellow? How many think green? Green?
It's not present in the blue, right? I just wanted to tell everyone in the blue.
Okay. Everyone thinks blue, right? Why? We will say that now the notion of sign will come from the following. Let's say that the yellow class is plus 1 and the blue class is minus 1. The prediction would be for this case, for the first classifier, what are you predicting for this point? Minus 1, you're predicting as blue, right? For the second class, for the second iteration, what are you predicting? You're again predicting blue. For the third iteration, you're predicting to be yellow, right? Because this hollow circle is somewhere in the yellow region, right? So now the prediction is given by the sine of each of these multiplied by the alpha terms. 0.42 into minus 1 plus 0.66 into minus 1 plus 0.99 into plus 1, which is slightly negative, a very small amount negative. Thus, we assign the fourth thing as the negative class or the blue class. Right? Everyone clear with this? So, it would be a good exercise to think about the different points. Let's say if there is a point over here, let's say. What will it be? Blue, because 0.42 into blue plus 0.99 into blue. And let's say it was over here, so minus 0.66 into here. It will still be a positive, it will still be negative and blue. Right? Okay. What about multi class? Okay, so does anyone have any thoughts on what do we do with multi-class classifiers? So you don't directly do that. For multi-class, there is some more theory I want to teach you first. So you won't do a prediction on yellow versus blue. Let's say there are three colors. RGB, red, green, red, blue, green. So if you have to do multi-class, you do red versus remain, blue versus remain, green versus remain. So that is how you end up doing, in general, multi-class classification. You can also do pairwise. So multi-class classification, you generally call two methods. One is called one versus one. So you predict red versus blue, red versus green, red versus yellow. And the other is called one versus all. Red versus remaining, blue versus remaining, yellow versus remaining. There are two of these approaches. You could apply each of them over there. Okay, now some intuition behind the weight update formula. I've plotted the error of the ML iteration with alpha m. What was the relation between alpha m and error? Does anyone remember? Log of 1 minus alpha n divided by 1 minus error n divided by alpha n both that. So, can you see that this is the kind of curve that you get for the expression? You have for error equal to 0.5, the term becomes 1 minus error n divided by error of m. So, 1 minus 0.5 divided by 0.5 is 0.5. Log of that is 0, right? So e to the power 0 is 1. So for error m equal to 0.5, you get this. If the error is high, this alpha m term is low. And if the error is low, the error alpha m term is high. If you don't get the entire curve, you can just plot it in 2 minutes in NumPy and MATLAB, which is exactly what it is. But what is more important is to look at the weight multiplier. What were the weight multipliers? We said that for a correctly classified point, the weight multiplier is e to the power minus alpha n, and for the wrongly classified one, it is e to the power alpha. Right? So now these are the two quantities which we want to look at, and then interpret how all of this is related to boost. Okay. So what I have plotted in the red curve is e to the power alpha n, and what I have got to do though is e to the power minus alpha n. So there are a few reasons I want you to focus on. First, when error m is close to 0,
what happens?
If error m is close to 0, then the red quantity is very high. The red quantity is, so this is the red, this is the red curve and this is the green curve, right? If alpha is very low, the red quantity is very high. If alpha, sorry, not alpha, if error m is low, then e to the power alpha m is a very high quantity and e to the power minus alpha is a very low quantity. These were now the multipliers, right? Error m being low means what? Okay, so for the incorrectly classified, for the correctly classified samples, which will be with having low error, so you'll have the term for the, so the multiplier for the correct one was e to the power minus alpha, right? So the weight of the correctly classified samples would be reduced. The weight of the incorrectly classified samples would be very high. Similarly, on the other end, you can see the opposite things. Ideally, you would always want the error to be fairly low. We'll now quickly go on to the final algorithm for today, which is on random forest. One of the most popular algorithms. So it's a in several decision trees, as you would have thought, the trees make forest, and several trees are making forest. The only main thing of difference here that you want to notice is that each tree is trained on randomly selected features. So at the start of the lecture, we discussed three different ways in which you could create an image. One is various data set. One, varied hyperparameters. One, varied features. So random forest is looking at the case when you vary the features. You end up selecting features randomly. From, so you select a random subset of the entire features. And because the features are randomly selected, we end up with learning decorrelated trees. So this was one of the important conditions when we were discussing the theory of ensemble learning. That you want to learn the classifiers which are not correlated to each other. And because they end up learning decorrelated trees, they eventually help in reducing the variance. This is the entire algorithm for random forest. So once you build a tree, the only thing you need to do is for each tree, so for each classifier of each tree, at each node when you are trying to split, so in decision trees, you look at all the remaining attributes, right? In random forest, you choose a subset m of the available n attributes. That is it. So there is nothing substantially complicated in random forest. And you, when this m subset that you choose could be on the order of square root of m. In some of the examples that I showed, I chose m equal to 1. So I was only around one feature from the entire set of attributes. That would lead to highly decorrelated. Everyone clear on this algorithm? At each stage, at each node when you're considering a split, instead of looking at all the possible attributes, you look at a subset of attributes of the all possible attributes. Sorry? For all the trees, for each node. That is how for each tree you end up learning a highly decorrelated. I'll show a very quick demonstration of how random forest work on RS dataset, which is a part of the time also. This is decision tree number one. This is where you see the petal length and the petal width. Petal length and the petal width are the only two attributes which appear there. In another tree, petal width, petal length appear. In another tree, you see petal width, petal width, petal width, petal length, sepal length, petal length, sepal width, sepal length. And all of these are just picks to be, I said that I'm only learning with depth two trees. I didn't want to go much deeper into these. Another tree is petal length, petal width, sepal width. Zeppelin, Petalin. So as you can see that these trees look very, very different to each other because now they could be decorated because of the training process that we involved. So what eventually we will end up with is multiple of these very different trees. Sorry? How many number of trees in the region? So the question is how do we decide the number of trees you so the number of trees that you use is another hyperparameter of the approach. So you fix that before learning. You can vary the number of trees, so you can vary the hyperparameter. Use the hyperparameter which gives you the best performance over the cross validation. Right? So you can vary things like the max depth of a tree. You can vary things like number of trees, number of estimators, or number of inferable elements that you use. All of these are hyperparameters. You can find the optimum one using cross validation. So there is another interesting property which random forest provides us. I guess many of you who've done some practical machine learning would have seen that random forest give you the feature importance. Anyone has seen that? So you've seen feature importance using random forest. Now let's look at a slide which tells us how it gives the feature importance. Any idea on that? How can random forest tell which features are more important? Okay. So if you don't consider, can you boil it down to something simpler? You're on the right track.
Which attribute is more important?
Okay, which attribute is more important? And because you have multiple of these things. Okay. Yeah, so you are selecting attributes randomly, but let's assume you have a large enough incentive. But each of the attributes, you're giving a fair chance. But it's not that you're biasing your attributes to a certain set of attributes. And that way, you're still giving everyone a fair chance. And this is not an exact thing, that's why. Features? Yeah, so the features which appear higher would likely be very important because they end up, you know, deciding the path of the entire tree. That's another good intuition.
We have
these
three
models. Yeah. So all of you are pretty much on the same track. You don't weight models, you weight the information gain or the purity measure you get at each mode. Looks a little complicated, right? Don't worry, we'll just walk over each of these. You have m different trees. Which is shown by this phi. So phi 1 through phi m are m different trees. You're trying to find the importance of a variable x, j. Let's say in the previous example we had variables like petal and sepalin. You're trying to find the importance of them. You firstly have to average it over m trees. So that looks like a simple term. Jt is the variable you add node t, so you have an identity function over that. So which is basically trying to say is that for each, you figure out where xj occurs in the tree, right? Where does xj, the variable xj occurs? You can find that using this identity function, jt equal to j, right? Once you figure that out, you then see the probability, so you see the number of samples that particular node sees, compared to the number of samples originally passed in the data, right? What this means is that nodes which are higher are somewhat more important, right? Because they were chosen first in the initial sample, the initial attribute to figure out the reduction in entropy, right? So they're likely more important. Thus, you see that NT over N is an important part. The second is the impurity reduction at node P, which is just the information. So in some sense, what this whole formula is doing, you look at the information gain at this particular node where this feature occurs. You weigh that by the number of samples which you are now scraping on, right? Compared to the total number of samples that you have in the data. You average this number across multiple of these intervals or multiple of these trees. You finally come up with a number of buttons of a particular feature. I did this on the on the ideal basis, and in terms of the petal length was significantly more important than the other. Any doubt in this? Any doubt in the formula? Okay, in that case, let's end today's lecture. We meet on Wednesday at the same time, 5 to 6:30. Your assignment deadline has been shifted by 24 hours plus 1 hour, 25.5.